Was this the biggest climate science scandal? The 20-year anniversary. What could be worse than news that the corals of the world's biggest coral reef system, the biggest by far, the Great Barrier Reef, had experienced an unprecedented slowdown in growth? It would not be long before the corals would stop growing altogether. In other words, the end of the Great Barrier Reef and all the other corals on Earth. No biggie. They said the coral growth rates, which were recorded in the growth rings of corals, just like rings in trees, tree rings in trees, had been more or less stable from 1570 to 1990 and then started to precipitately decline to 2005, when the data stopped. 20 years ago now. You can imagine the headlines. It went all around the world and it was a major influence in convincing the public that climate change was a diabolical disaster. It's akin to claiming that all the trees in the whole world reduced their growth rate by 15% between 1990 and 2005. But the trouble was that it was all wrong, and they've never admitted it, and even more scandalous, they spat the dummy and stopped taking the data since 2005. Now, you're likely thinking, well, maybe we made the mistake and maybe they were right. So, without going into the details, consider this. This well-funded institution have coral growth data on the Great Barrier Reef by sampling massive corals, very, very old corals, going right back from 1570 to 2005. And they said the coral growth rate suddenly dropped massively from 1990 to 2005. But they haven't measured, or certainly have not published, any data from 2005 to now. Now, why would that be? If there was a massive slowdown in growth between 1990 and 2005, it would be kind of nice to know if this had continued and got even worse the way they implied. Growth, according to them, should be now at least 30% slower than 1990 by this year. You'd think the last 20 years of data would be the most interesting. If the coral was declining so fast, surely we would want to know, surely the science institutions would want to be able to tell us that that was the case, to confirm that they were correct. Or maybe, just maybe, they know that they were wrong, even though they would not admit it, and taking any more data would just show utterly definitively that they were wrong. Perhaps we can't blame them for not wanting to be shown to be wrong, but is this what we expect from our science institutions? Okay, so let's bury into the detail. You see, these massive types of corals have yearly growth rings, just like tree rings. So if you drill a hole into these corals and measure the width and density of the coral ring, you have some measure of how fast it grows. And the best thing is, as mentioned before, if for an enormous coral, which is very, very old, they record their own growth rates, sometimes for hundreds of years. For the Great Barrier Reef, we've got data going back to 1570. Now, it turns out that the work on these coral growth rings started in the early 1980s at the Australian Institute of Marine Science, where I used to work at that time, in fact. But in those days, climate change just wasn't a thing. Nobody was really interested in that. And they were interested in just doing good science, and it was found that these growth bands also contained chemical markers that gave data on the strength of river floods, going back hundreds of years. The river floods was the interest back then. Well, that work more or less stopped and more or less died out, and the last cores that were collected around 1990. Does that date, 1990, ring a bell? But then in the early 2000s, with all the hoo-ha about climate change, it was decided to see if the coral growth rates had started to slow due to increasing temperature and carbon dioxide levels from burning coal, etc. People were theorising that the growth rates would slow down. So they dusted off the old corals and they had already collected, but of course they only went till 1990 when the last core was taken. So they needed to go out and take new data for the corals that had been happily growing from 1990 to 2005. So they collected a whole bunch of new corals, but this time, instead of using the really great big huge corals all the time, which needed a big underwater drill, was very time consuming and expensive to do, they largely just collected small corals and medium-sized corals, holus bolus, to measure the growth rates. But these small corals are very young, many just 10 to 30 years old, and they assumed, and this is the crucial point, that little young corals grow at the same rate as big old corals. They effectively changed the sampling method for the data between 1570 and 1990, and the data between 1990 and 2005 by changing the types of coral they were sampling. Changing sampling methods is a very risky thing to do. You just shouldn't ever do it. And as it turns out, it looks like the coral growth rates slow as they age. Trees often do the same thing. Anyway, they put the two sets data sets together, and this is what they found. A catastrophe. Coral growth rates slowed by 15% between 1990 and 2005. By 2025, if they'd actually bothered to take any data, they should be growing a good 30% slower. Now, it turns out that 2005 was roughly the time when I'd started to realise that there was quite a lot of catastrophism about the reef, which just wasn't justified. It was also a time that, our lab was earning a lot of money doing consultancy work, so we decided to devote some of our resources to check out this dismal data, to see if it stacked up. It was about a year of work, but well worth it in the end, because it turned out that the Ames guys had made two major mistakes. One, to be fair, they've actually corrected that. They messed up the measurement of the last coral ring. But the other error, that fundamental error of using the young small corals largely after 1990, exactly when the drop-off occurred, and huge coral before that, well, that error they have not corrected at all. We reanalyzed the data, but only used big corals that they'd collected after 1990 to try to keep things as consistent as possible with a somewhat flawed data set. We just excluded the really ridiculously small corals. And you find that there is no reduction in calcification rate. In fact, you can easily see in the data that when you exclude data from corals that were younger than 5, 10 or 20 years of age at the time of sampling, then the supposed drop in growth rate disappears. We showed effectively that the corals just slowed down their growth rates in the first couple of decades, and Ames suddenly introducing these young corals into the equations messed things up, especially with the rather strange statistical analysis they used, which I won't go into. Anyway, Ames disagreed with what we did, although they didn't really explain why using just the bigger corals gave such a different result. But fair enough, maybe we're not getting it. The thing is that it's very easy to resolve. I actually challenged Ames to go out and take the data again. This was in 2019. It's a very simple task to do the job properly, keeping the same methodology this time. And also, and this is crucial, updating the data from 2005 to when we want it, which is right now. That's the most interesting part. So we challenged them to that. And what did we get? Well, all sorts of excuses, a vague promise, this is back in 2019, that maybe they'll do it sometime in the future. And now we're at 2025 and still zippo. 1570 to 2005, we've got data, but nothing for the last 20 years. Lots of claims that coral growth is slowing, a paper in the literature which is still being cited to this day as though it's correct. An issue that is central to the claims of climate change is a catastrophe, that all the world's corals are going to disappear, and a scientific institution that refuses to take the crucial data in spite of being in receipt of way over $1 billion in funding since 2005. You would think they'd be able to find a few shekels to do this important job. Anyway, we live in hope. Sooner or later, it's going to happen one way or the other. And it will settle the dispute once and for all. I'll make the prediction that there will be no change in the calcification of the growth rate. Ames have been predicting for 20 years that there will have been a massive slowdown that should have got far worse, in fact. So, is this the worst example of a science institution acting badly on climate change, like I said in the title? Well, you know, it's up there, but there are just so many, aren't there? Like the ClimateGate emails where they dodged up the data, or the scandalous hockey stick curve where they certainly dodged up the data, or the claims that all the Himalayan glaciers would be melted by last week. You know, I just wonder whether I did a bit of a clickbaity title, because there are so many of these scandal. Maybe this is not the greatest of them all. So if you think I've clickbaited you into watching this video, unsubscribe and dislike, or else just don't do that. Thanks very much.